I entered this field in 2019, and of course I didn't stop my other work, but maybe I should have done it. Okay, I think, or I hope you're going to find these fast radio bursts fascinating. William, it doesn't move on. Nereye doğru yapmalıyım? Okay. Evet. Tabii. Tamam. Evet. Mm-hmm. So, I'll first talk about the discovery of the fast radio bursts, and then I'll describe some of the observational properties, and then some of the models proposed to explain the fast radio bursts, and then the recent observational findings that are converging to an opinion on these objects. So let's start with the discovery. Here you see the Parkes telescope, radio telescope, which is 64 meters in diameter, and it's in Australia. In July 24th, this telescope received a signal, a bright radio signal, as you see here. And the discovery was made by Duncan Lorimer and his group. Duncan Lorimer is famous in pulsar astronomy, and yet, you know, astronomers were a bit suspicious about the discovery, even at that time. Well, this was published in Science at a time, and now we think this is the moment this new era has started, and we call this object that was discovered as FRB 010724, about a date. This is year, year, month, month, day, day convention, as you well know. Okay. Okay, although the radio band is transparent, the atmosphere is transparent in the radio band, and we have been exploiting this since Carl Jansky started radio astronomy, the results of Lorimer was a bit suspicious at that time, simply because we know there's a lot of interference from the surroundings, right? You can make false detections easily because our instruments are interfering with the radio telescopes. Of course, astronomers have methods to characterize whether the signal is coming from space or the Earth, but there had been some doubts. More on to this, there had been discovered a new event called peritons, right? They had a very similar shape with the Lorimer burst that I have introduced just ago. They are also radio pulses. Somehow astronomers understood from the beginning that these are terrestrial events, not astronomical events, but they are very similar to the Lorimer burst discovered by Duncan Lorimer in 2007. And so people were curious whether the Lorimer burst was also something terrestrial. Okay, so these are the peritons. And up to that time, pulsar astronomers were always doing Fourier search because they were expecting to observe periodic pulses from neutron stars, right? So detecting individual pulses is something different. And in order to detect more of these fast radio bursts, they had to modify the algorithms of detection. And once this was done, they were able to detect other fast radio bursts appearing to come from space. And apparently, now there are about 600 fast radio bursts detected, and there had been catalogs for them, and the paper of Lorimer's is getting a lot of hits, as you see here. So this is a bursting field of research, right? Fast radio burst research is bursting. And the source of peritons has been identified now. It is just a microwave oven in the observatory, right? Someone is opening it at times before it stops at a normal pace, right? So they even could test it with a ceramic mug of water, right? And then they just succeeded in producing peritons. But they also showed that Lorimer bursts cannot be of terrestrial origin, because there was no one at that time in the observatory. Okay. So if we assume now that these are astronomical events, we can ask a few questions. Well, what is the central engine of these fast radio bursts? Do they emit in other wavelengths? What is the event rate of fast radio bursts? How common are they? And if they are cosmological events, as they are indeed, then why don't we detect less luminous but more common ones nearby, right? And are they one-off events or are they repeating, right? So astronomers are going to answer these questions. So this brings us to the second chapter, which is observational properties. First of all, the duration. The duration is short, 1 millisecond. That means something is changing within a millisecond. It cannot be an ordinary star, right? The ordinary star cannot change within a millisecond. The speed of light, right, puts a limit onto any causally connected change. And so we can put a limit from the millisecond. So the size should be about 30 million centimeters. That just immediately tells us that it should be a black hole or a neutron star, because these are the most compact objects that can satisfy these criteria. Even white dwarfs would not work. A white dwarf is of the size of the Earth, right? But not all astronomical events are isotropic. Some events are usually beamed, and in the presence of beaming, the energy estimates and other things will change. Okay, first of all, let's talk about the dispersion of the radio waves. The universe is filled with plasma, and the plasma is a dispersive media for the radio waves. There's the dispersion relation is, as you see here, it's very well known. So when you look at the Lorimer burst, first of all, you see that there's a range of frequencies, and this is when they are arriving to the instrument. So smaller frequencies arrive later, right? So this is a result of the dispersion of the signal throughout its path. From this dispersion, astronomers can tell the distance of a radio source, right? So this integral here, this part, is called a dispersion measure in astronomy. And if you are talking about a cosmological source, then you should consider the redshift due to the expansion of the universe. So this equation would be modified. And by using the dispersion of radio pulsar signals, astronomers have understood the structure of the galaxy very well, the spiral arms. Most of the electrons are in the spiral arms because most of the baryons are in the spiral arms. Remember, plasma is a neutral thing in the end, right? So as you have electrons somewhere, you should have some baryons around. So when we look at the dispersion measure of fast radio bursts, we see that they are systematically larger than what the galaxy can give us. So all the radio pulsars that we have been detected in the galaxy have dispersion measures less than 200, but the fast radio bursts have much larger. Well, when you go out of the galaxy, the density of the intergalactic medium is several orders of magnitude smaller than the density of the galaxy. So the dispersion measure differences do not go linearly, right? So in the galaxy, right, 200, but 335 does not mean something very nearby, because now the density, once you go out of the galaxy, the density has reduced several orders of magnitude. But anyway, you could also have that, for example, a supernova remnant. The object could be in a supernova remnant. There's a lot of electrons in there. So this could enhance the dispersion measure. So the object could still be somewhere inside the galaxy or somewhere nearby galaxy. So dispersion measure is not easily or directly a measure of the distance. We should measure it by an independent way. And that was succeeded somewhat long time ago, 2016. This is long time ago for FRBs. So the redshift is immediately showing us that the source of the FRB is something cosmological, right? It's in a very distant galaxy, somewhat billions of light years away. And today, we have a lot of measured redshifts of fast radio bursts. And once you know the dispersion measure and the redshift, you can make up a dispersion measure redshift relation to locate the distribution of electrons within the intergalactic medium. This allowed the astronomers to find the missing baryons. What do I mean by this? We know that 5% of the universe is normal matter, right? Half of this was still missing. I mean, we only knew the other half that was in the galaxies, and galaxy formation scenarios told us that the other half should be in the intergalactic medium, but there was no way to know. Now, with the fast radio burst, the signal passing and smelling every electron on its path is telling us that they are in the intergalactic medium. So this is a famous paper that's the impact of fast radio bursts on cosmology. Now let's talk about the fast radio burst rate. How common are these sources? They are happening. Well, the radio telescope just looks at a region of the angular diameter of the moon's size, right? So you cannot know what's happening elsewhere, right? Something happening in a millisecond, if you're lucky, you're detecting it. So you need to rely on statistics, how many of them are occurring in a single day in a sky that is about 10,000 occurrences, right? So 10,000 events occur per sky per day. More important is the event rate density. So above a certain luminosity, how many fast radio bursts are there in a certain volume, right? So this number is so high. I mean, we don't know any other source that can do this. Just to compare, neutron star mergers, right? They are at least an order of magnitude less common. I mean, some models, for example, suggested that fast radio bursts come from neutron star mergers. Well, that could form a big neutron star, not collapsing into a black hole simply because it's rotating very fast. And then when it slows down, it would just collapse into a black hole and hopefully give us a fast radio burst, but that doesn't work simply out of the FRB rate that we discover. I mean, we don't cannot have so many neutron star mergers. So astronomers have found that if they are one-off events, that means they are cataclysmic, destroying themselves once they happen. If they were such objects, then nothing would, nothing we know of would provide them for us. They must be so common. But hopefully, a repeating fast radio burst was discovered. So thousands of fast radio bursts were discovered from the same region of the sky with the same dispersion measure. So you can be sure that it's the same source. And a lot of them are now discovered since then, right? This is a big opportunity to study such sources now. Because, you know, the resolution is not very good with the radio. I mean, you cannot locate the galaxy if it is a one-off event, but if it is repeating, then you can turn your other cameras to that direction and locate the source. Okay, so it is understood that at least some of them are repeating. Probably all of them are repeating. We just cannot notice. Maybe the repetition time is long, right? This is possible. So how does it go into the media? A mysterious and powerful radio signal from space is repeating itself. Wow, I would read that. So direct localization of these fast radio bursts give us the redshifts nicely. Now, what is the energy released in a fast radio burst then? This is about what our sun would release in a week, right? The energy estimate is what our sun would release in a week. But of course, the flux we receive is very small. Your cell phone on the moon would be, you know, 1,000 times weaker. Okay, and all models would predict that, there would be also emission in the higher frequencies like X-rays and gamma rays once such a burst happens. But if they are cosmological events, you may not be detecting them simply because they are absorbed more. Okay, what is most remarkable is the brightness temperature of these sources, right? The brightness temperature is very much used in astronomy. It's not really a measure of the temperature most of the time. It's a measure of the intensity, and it's usually very high. It's not the temperature of the source itself, because the sources are usually non-thermal sources. And let me remind you, the Planck temperature is about 10 to the 32 kelvins. Now these fast radio bursts would have brightness temperatures reaching about 10 to the 40 kelvin, 8 orders of magnitude larger than the Planck temperature. And this is simply because they are very coherent sources of radio waves. So you must find an energy source that's going to do all of this coherently, right? Now, if this is too much of a brightness temperature, you can just compare it with the antenna, right? The typical antenna can have temperatures, brightness temperatures, reaching about the Planck temperature. Anyway, up to that time, the most coherent sources we know of were the radio pulsars, but fast radio bursts exceed them by several orders of magnitude. And we still do not understand, after 50 years of work, we still do not understand the origin of coherent emission from radio pulsars. How can we understand something happening in a millisecond, right? Not continuously measured. Now, in astrophysical contexts, coherent emission can be achieved in two ways, either via the simplistic antenna mechanism. You have a bunch of electric charges, and the size of the bunch is smaller than the wavelength of the emission, so you get a coherent emission. But how can you put so many charges together, right? You need about 1 coulomb of charge sitting together. You're measuring these in gigahertz, so you need something in a 30 centimeter, 1 coulomb of charge in a 30 centimeter. How can it be? The other one is the Maser mechanism. Somehow you have population inversion in these systems, and that's believed to be the coherent emission from the polar cap of Jupiter. They are both discussed in the context of radio pulsars, and some have been applied to fast radio bursts as well. Now, the polarization of these sources, some are 100% polarized, linearly polarized. And recently, we have an active and repeating fast radio burst, and it started to emit circularly polarized waves. And we have also understood that the polarization state depends on the frequency. In higher frequencies, you detect the polarization, but when you go below a critical frequency, you see no polarization, even with the best telescope, which has 500 meters aperture. And we have some evidence that these sources have large magnetic fields around. We can measure the Faraday rotation. That means the following: if you have a magnetized plasma and the electromagnetic waves pass through this magnetized plasma, the polarization angle polarization will be angled. So if it has a component along your line of sight, it will be moving in this direction. Okay, so we have, apart from the dispersion measure, we have a rotation measure for these objects. And this is telling us that, well, there's a lot of magnetic fields on the path and probably near the source. And some of the sources have extreme rotation measures, and these rotation measures are fluctuating dramatically. Now comes the models of the fast radio bursts. What could they be, right? in mysterious verse. Well, they are little green men. They're just doing sales with their sun, right? The energy from the sun. And sometimes they're sending us these signals somehow. Why coherent? Why this is so? I don't understand. And how this paper gets published, I don't understand it as well. This is more mysterious than fast radio bursts. And implications of fast radio bursts for superconducting cosmic strings? Do they ever exist? And collisions between neutron stars, asteroids, comets, they're also, you know, favored. And mergers of charged black holes? Well, black holes can have charge, but macroscopic objects do not usually get charged, right? This is not charged. And so astrophysical black holes, the real ones, we don't expect them to be charged anyway. But, you know, the event is so remarkable, you have to come up with a remarkable idea. And the charged black hole, astrophysical black hole, is a remarkable idea. And some quantum gravity effects that I don't want to mention. And again, charged black holes, because Kerr-Newman black holes are the charged black holes, and the collapse of the magnetospheres of them. Now, there had been so many of such weird ideas that somebody had to make a catalog of the theories, not the events, but the theories, a theory catalog. I have seen such a thing for the first time. And you can imagine the reflections in the media, Harvard theories, how sailing aliens could have caused fast radio bursts. Yeah. Mysteries, fast radio bursts from deep space could be aliens? No way. Okay. Now, let's talk about the conventional models. Well, the coherency of the emission is just telling us that an extreme kind of neutron star could be at play. Well, we know neutron stars do emit coherent radiation, but somewhat less extreme than the fast radio bursts. Maybe you can have an extreme neutron star that can do this. Well, let's remind us about the neutron stars. We have rotationally powered pulsars, which have magnetic fields reaching up to 10 to the 12 Gauss. But then there's another type of neutron star called a magnetar. It has even stronger magnetic fields, like 10 to the 14 Gauss. And magnetars can have even stronger toroidal fields inside because of the dynamo process they pass through during their birth. And we have been observing magnetars since 1990s, identifying and observing them. They give us X-ray bursts and they have been showing extreme events, but no fast radio bursts up to that. Now, rotationally powered pulsars, they were discovered by Antoni Hevish and his student Jocelyn Bell. They are identified as rapidly rotating magnetized neutron stars. And here you see Jocelyn Bell giving a talk for the Astronomy Club of Istanbul Technical University. I really recommend this talk. Anyway, what do I mean by being rotationally powered? They are spinning down. For example, the Crab pulsar, the most famous of these rotationally powered pulsars, is spinning down by a microsecond in a year. And so omega and omega dot is the rotational power. And this microsecond slowdown is powering all about the nebula around the pulsar, actually. So it corresponds to a huge energy output, 100,000 times greater than the solar energy output. Up to now, we have discovered about 3,000 pulsars, rotationally powered pulsars, in our own galaxy. And we see the pulses simply because of the lighthouse effect, the magnetic pole. The magnetic pole passes from our line of sight as the neutron star rotates, and we just see a pulse, lighthouse effect. And this is the Crab Nebula, and at the center of this Crab Nebula, there is this pulsar with 33 milliseconds, and the periderivative, as you see here, this corresponds to microsecond slowdown in a year, if you multiply it with a year. And so the energy power output is 100,000 times greater than the energy output of the sun. And most importantly, it's doing this energy in the radio band in a coherent way. Of course, it's emitting in X-rays and gamma rays. It's active in all wavelengths. Most of the output, energy output, is in the X-rays and gamma rays. But of course, we detect the radio waves more easily. And so we call it sometimes a radio pulsar. Actually, it's pulsating in the gamma and X-rays too. Now, these crab-like pulsars sometimes emit giant pulses. What do I mean? You see, about a few thousands of each, and many pulses, I mean, you see many pulses here. You know, after several thousand pulses, you get a giant pulse, and then another giant pulse, and so on. Right? So this object is emitting, some of the rotationally powered pulsars are emitting giant pulses. Now, imagine you put the Crab Nebula to a nearby galaxy, and you cannot get the regular pulses, but just the giant pulses, right? Then it would just appear as a fast radio burst to you, right? That's the idea. And we call it the giant pulse model for the fast radio burst. And that's the most conventional model you can come up with, okay? And more remarkably, these giant pulse, when you look at it more carefully, you would see that it's made up of nanosecond shots, right? What does a nanosecond shot mean? It means something about 30 centimeters is doing this, right? Nanosecond. Okay. From an astronomical distance, you measure something happening in a fraction of a meter, right? Now, important about these neutron stars is the characteristic radius called the light cylinder radius here. This is the radius at which a rigidly rotating magnetic field line would reach the speed of light. So this is actually separating the radiation zone from the nearby zone. Okay, and giant pulse phenomena is not only observed with very magnetic objects like crab pulsar, but it's also observed with millisecond pulsars, which are very old systems, and they have a reduced magnetic field, about 10 to the 9 Gauss, well, 3 orders of magnitude smaller, right? But they still show giant pulses because the magnetic field at a light cylinder is large. So magnetic field at a light cylinder is an important parameter for these objects. So because they're rotating very fast, the light cylinder is very close to the neutron star, and you can have strong fields still. Now, right beyond the light cylinder, there's an equatorial current sheet and magnetic fields in opposite directions. And we know what happens when you have magnetic fields in opposite directions. Well, magnetic reconnection. That's a well-known process in plasma physics. But anyway, if the magnetic field and the rotation axis are not aligned, then you would get this ballerina skirt effect, as you see here. So this current sheet would be moving in this fashion, and you would have all the other stuff on top of that. Okay, so this is a cartoon where the rotation and magnetic axes are aligned, but in this case, they're not aligned, and you see this effect. But anyway, you can have magnetic reconnection on the current sheet, and the formation of plasmoids, the magnetic islands, follow this process. It's well known in magnetic reconnection. It's a very well-known topic in plasma physics, in active, and I urge the graduate students to do this Turing mode calculation. You have two opposite magnetic fields with a current sheet between them, and you give a perturbation, and you're going to show that this is an unstable configuration. And we know this event happens in the sun. For example, you can have these outflows due to magnetic reconnection in the sun. And it's a topology change. And these plasmoids that I have talked about is like the vortices in the fluid, right? Ordinary neutral fluid, you have vortices, and fluid dynamics studied these vortices a lot. Now, plasma physicists studied these plasmoids since 1960s, right? These instabilities are very well known. Now, you're going to have a chain of plasmoids beyond the light cylinder, and these plasmoids will have a dynamics of their own. And they have detected the enhancement of X-ray radiation with the giant pulses of the Crab pulsar. Anyway, these are the most conventional models for production of coherent radio emission. So fast radio bursts can come from the plasmoids generated beyond the light cylinder of an extreme neutron star. But there's still, luminosity is a bit lower in that sense. So we need more extreme objects, probably magnetars. Magnetars have two orders of magnitude larger magnetic fields. They don't show too much radio. Occasionally they show it. And this is very different than radio pulsars that emit, continuous emission. They occasionally show very high bursts, like 10 to the 41 Hertz per second. And we know about 30 galactic magnetars in our galaxy. And three of them showed more remarkable bursts, like 10 to the 44, 10 to the 46 Hertz. The last one occurred in 2004, and it was it emitted 10 to the 46 Hertz per second. Within a fraction of a second, this event emitted what the sun would emit in 250,000 years. It's so remarkable. And it's just a magnetic storm on the surface of a magnetar. Now, it was 50,000 light years away. if it wasn't 50,000 light years away, but only 50 light years away, our atmosphere would blow away and we just wouldn't notice it. I mean, we wouldn't have the time to say, oh, something is approaching us because it's approaching us with the speed of light. Right? We would all go extinct in that event. And actually, that event started a research whether some of the mass extinction events in biology were the result of magnetar bursts that occurred nearby. So these 10 to the 41 Earths per second events are more common, but these ones happened only three times from three different magnetars. Now, the energy distribution of repeating FRBs is very similar to the bursts from magnetars. And we came up with a model for the emission of fast radio bursts some time ago, but actually it was the first paper to originate, to come from Turkey on this subject. So we suggested the plasma media being nonlinear for the transmission of these radio bursts and leading these nonlinear effects and the solitary waves would allow us to get some of the energy requirements more easily because of the energy not being dispersed into 4 pi stradians, but only you know, in a cone. So what is happening towards the resolution? Okay, a millisecond duration radio burst from a galactic magnetar. So from a galactic magnetar here, the astronomers detect fast radio bursts. During the X-ray burst, well, there are thousands of bursts happening, but only two of them also emit fast radio bursts, and the astronomers detect it. So this is a smoking gun for what's happening with the fast radio bursts. They are magnetars, most likely. But are they all? I mean, look at the date, by the way. This is submitted May 2020, and our paper was accepted in March 2020, 2 months earlier. Anyway, so the neutron star models win at this stage. But crab-like nanoshots were also discovered with the fast radio bursts. And now the whole area of this diagram, where you have the time, transient duration and the spectral luminosity altogether, every part of the diagram is getting filled, and we have a continuum of events. I'm going to summarize briefly. The subject is getting matured. Now the number of sources outcome the number of theories. Once the number of theories were greater than the number of fast radio bursts, that was just signaling that it was an immature field, but now it is quite mature. We have many observational breakthroughs, and the models have been constrained dramatically, and the magnetar model is the converging opinion is that the magnetar model can satisfy most of the criteria. But of course, we don't know many things, how this coherent radiation is produced in the magnetosphere of a magnetar, right? But we know where to look now. We can start making calculations. Okay, thank you very much for listening. Any time for questions?
Yes, I guess we can take a couple of questions. Sanjan, the mic is here.
If there's anything from Zoom, please let me know as well. Sol tarafta mesela. Sol.
Hi, Kazım Hocam. Thanks for the very nice talk. So there are also like these rock waves in oceans once in a while. It's observed that also sinks the ship, which there are lots of also discussion about that, whether you can get them in a linear system or it's a nonlinear event and so on. And they happen all of a sudden. Did anyone, look any connection between rock waves in the ocean and this fast bursts in these magnetars?
I have never seen such a connection. But I should check.
Thanks.
Maybe one last question from Nicola.
I was wondering, thanks for the very nice talk. Have you tried correlating the bursts with what's seen at neutrino observatories?
No, I think nobody has done it yet.
Is there plans to try and do it, or is it not interesting?
I don't think so. I mean, they are happening sporadically. You don't expect it anywhere, right? And the telescope is looking at a certain direction all the time. While the Earth is rotating, it's not rotating with the Earth. It's just looking at the same direction. It's not feasible, I think, at this stage.
No, I don't mean to use your telescopes to detect neutrino. I just mean because, you know, in neutrino observatories, you often also see bursts, and now they're also thinking that it's coming from various cosmological events. The bursts that the neutrino telescopes see, I was just wondering if you've tried overlapping them in time and intensity with, you know, the radio bursts.
I think there are predictions for the presence of neutrinos, but I don't think anyone made this connection, direct connection with a certain burst of neutrinos and a fast radio bursts. They should occur around the same time. I didn't see any connection really made.
Okay, thanks.
But I think the proposal is just to make a cross check whether time wise there's a
great idea, but I don't think effect, there is, right? Such a thing done yet.
Yeah,
directly. Okay. But there could be some prediction.
So thanks once again for this great
talk. Thank you for the invitation.
Thank you.
Appreciate you.
So now we have our last speaker for the morning session of today. We'll have Gökhan Ünel from University of California, Irvine. On stage, and he will talk on building low-cost MEV level transportable accelerators. A sample of which he, I think, brought with himself and shared with us.
The title? No, the title is, in fact, coming from Professor Ilde. Okay. Thank you for having me here. Do I need to stay close to that microphone? Okay. Then in that case, I'll be here. Let's see. Yes. Okay. Thank you for having me here. Thank you for inviting me. I know this is the last talk before lunchtime. I'll try to be brief. I am somehow affiliated with Boğaziçi University as well. And Boğaziçi University is host to Kahve Laboratory. Kahve stands for Kandilli Algı Çızlandırıcı ve Enstrümantasyon. And here you can read the English. Initially, we have started working on particle physics, especially building detectors. But as you can guess, building detectors, at least testing detectors, requires some sort of a dedicated beam, and we have been working on building accelerators since a while. Of course, Boazici here is the host institute, but as you can see, as you can see here, there are other logos, other institutes as well, contributing by students, by researchers. Our location is this Feza Gürsey Institute in Kandilli campus in the Asian side of Istanbul. The idea here, the team. I couldn't find a picture that had everybody in it. Therefore, I tried to do a collage. But given my artistic abilities, this is the best that I could get. Of course, I missed the photos of a number of people. They are represented here by this person. Apologies to those. But anyway, the things are like at CERN, mostly done by our younger colleagues, and I thank them here. Okay. As I said, the idea was to build accelerators, but well, what do you accelerate? Electrons and protons. We started with electrons. At least this presentation starts with electrons because it's well, as we have all learned in one way or another, accelerating electrons is easy, in quotes. Mass is low, you basically blow and the electrons are accelerated. The electron part has been presented a lot of times in the past in this conference, in the previous editions. Therefore, I'm not going to spend too much time on it. However, I need to emphasize a few things. We have this 50 kilovolt electron gun, which we have used as a springboard project. A lot of other things sprung from that. It was a local design, something that we did the simulation, the testing, and the manufacturing, et cetera. And based on this project, we have tested a number of ideas. For example, typically, we started working with a tungsten cathode. Then we realized that, well, if you read the literature, you will find that as well. A toriated tungsten cathode gives a better results at lower temperature. Then lanthanum hexaborite gives a lot of electrons that has been tested. Dispenser cathodes are useful in other areas that has been tested as well. And these were presented, as I said, in the previous installments of this conference. When you have a high voltage setup, as you can see here, there is the high voltage setup. Here you see the cathode part. Here is the anode part. Here is the vacuum gauge. There are some magnets here that I will discuss. Here is a high voltage power supply. These are the insulators. And this whole chassis is on high voltage. There are these three cables bringing in the high voltage plus the current necessary to heat the cathodes. In here, you basically have a short distance in which you need to protect your high voltage from the rest of the system, which is naturally at ground level. Therefore, you need some sort of insulators. Typically, alumina insulators are used, but as you might guess, processing alumina is kind of difficult, needs to be purchased abroad. And with the, value of the Turkish lira, that's kind of difficult. PEEK as an alternative has been tested. We realized that it works well. If you want to go real cheap, the Teflon alternative that we are showing here, this white shiny object is Teflon. We have tested that idea as well. I was expecting it to heat up and melt, to admit the truth. And that didn't happen somehow. We don't even use forced air cooling. And I'm happy to report that it is available as an alternative. Now, one immediate correction you might say about this setup is that, well, you have open high voltage at 50 kilovolt. Yeah, that is true. But this is version zero. Version one has a better shielding and takes safety issues more seriously. What do we have here? We have a current source and we have a voltage source. These are used to control the electron current. That means I need to control the current on the cathode wire or, well, whatever equipment I'm using. Plus, I need to control the voltage on the secondary electrode, the so-called Van-Hout electrode, to turn off the beam when necessary. Okay, you can see it here. This is the wire, typically. This is my Van-Hout, and the electron beam is coming out here. To control that, you need to talk to these devices. But as I said, this device is at 50 kilovolts. Somehow you need to connect to these things and control. In literature, people typically use fiber optic connections to do this insulated communication. However, we found that it is possible to remotely access, control, and monitor via either Bluetooth or Wi-Fi. Bluetooth has its own issues, and frankly, I would recommend and I would prefer to use Wi-Fi. Once you have a beam out, you need magnets, as I said. I'm going to discuss a little bit about stirrers and focusing coils. And once you start doing things, you realize that sometimes due to, I guess, secondary effects, the beam intensity changes by itself. Therefore, you need a setup that would read the beam current through maybe the anode, the target, or the current provided by the current source, or eventually the current that you read on the high voltage power supply. And then you need to take action if you want to keep your electron beam current constant. If you feed all these things to a controller, for example, a PID controller, you can achieve an automatic beam control. It's a nice exercise. There is a LabVIEW module to do that, and it has been done. Now, concerning LabVIEW, we have initially started doing all our controls with LabVIEW on a single PC. Then we quickly realized that, well, LabVIEW was taking a lot of resources and it was kind of heavy on the CPU. Microcontrollers, especially PLCs, are in fact used more in industry for such things. People use LabVIEW maybe only as a nice graphical user interface with easily clickable buttons and easily changeable titles and such. So we have done that. I should also report that compared to previous years, we now have consolidated all the power supplies and control equipment in a single rack, nice and tidy, which I like. We did a lot of grounding work. Grounding is very important for our case, especially in the building that we were at that time, which was built for mathematical and theoretical physics. Electrical grounding was a real issue. Anyway, here we are with respect to the previous years. Okay. Now, steering the beam, of course, you need some sort of coil, some sort of magnet. You can order, but if you want to build a low-cost machine, of course, you start by designing something, and then you start by getting people to wind you some coils. If you go to the local industry, there are people winding coils, bobinage, they call themselves. However, we discovered that they promise you a number of turns, say 5, and you get 15. Or they promise you 15 and you get 5. So it is very important to measure. Naturally, you cannot simply measure the number of turns, but you can measure the resistance. to get the coils to up, at least approximately to the same resistance value. Then you need some sort of a structure to mount the coils. As you can guess, these two are working in tandem, and these two are working in tandem. In fact, if you power these two coils, depending on the direction of the current, the magnetic field that will be in the diagonal direction. The other thing, you somehow need to adjust and center this stirrer system. These things are also Teflon. We did these are small pieces. These are somehow larger pieces. They are very similar, therefore they are here. The smaller ones are for the electron beam line, and the larger ones are here for the proton beam line. And here you can see these things on the mounted on the beam line. The next thing is to focus the beam. Focusing the beam is, well, as you can guess, is done through solenoids. Again, you end up winding. Oops, wrong button again. This is for the electron setup. It is right after the beam goes, let's see, in this direction, in this photo. You have two stirrers that would move the beam up, down, left, right. And then you have the focusing coil here. This device is simply a vacuum valve that would isolate right-hand side from left-hand side. Solenoid sits here and it focuses the beam to a smaller cross section. However, before doing that, one has to make sure that the beam is very well centered because the effects are shown. The magnetic field is at its peak value only at the very, very center of the solenoid itself, physically at the center. R equals zero, if you want. This is also the setup for the proton beam line. I'm going to discuss the proton beam line a little bit later. However, since I was discussing beam focus, I didn't want to jump back and forth, so I'm showing that here. These are the two solenoids. This is the measurement setup from a while ago, and these are magnetic field values measured compared to the simulated at R equals zero, at the very center. Okay, next. Some applications. This was also discussed previously. Electron beam welding at least was discussed. What do you need to do for the electron beam welding? Well, you have the cathode, you have the anode, you have the two coils to center the beam. You have this coil to focus the beam, and you can move around the focused beam up, down, left, right, and you can use it for this kind of application. For the 50 kilovolt power supply, which can provide about 40 milliamps, you can do interesting things on various materials. But of course, you need some sort of a vacuum chamber. The vacuum chamber itself is not very big. Basically, it can take cylindrical objects of diameter of 10 centimeters and a height of about 20 centimeters. It's not big, but it does what it's supposed to do as a first setup. This thing has 2 degrees of freedom. It can rotate, or you can move it to the side. It can rotate either here or here. For the vacuum, we have separate vacuum pumps on the gun side and on the vacuum chamber side. On the welding side, if you like. And now you understand why we have this vacuum valve. When you want to change the sample that you are working on here, you need to isolate such that you can change and quickly return back to the operation. What else? Well, there are some tests that we have done here. I understand you might not see it very well. This is what okay, this is a piece of injector. Injectors are used in engines, gasoline engines. This is a component from a high performance gasoline engine manufacturer situated in Izmir, actually, in Turkey. Anyway, they used to do this with laser. A laser has its own advantages and disadvantages. electron beam welding by itself has been discussed in this platform previously, but let me just summarize that laser requires some sort of a gas to prevent oxidation. And also, if you compare depth versus width of the welding, electron beam welding does a much better job and does not require any post-processing. Of course, this is a classical welding TIG. You can see maybe the oxidation here. You would see some oxidation here had the image been a little bit clearer. And this is what we get out of electron beam welding. Of course, radiographic inspection shows that this is a perfect weld that can be used right away out of the machine. We have tried not only stainless steel, this is stainless steel component, by the way, but also other materials, stainless steel, the so-called 304 here, and some sort of titanium composite material, titanium aluminum that is typically used in industry, let me say. We also managed to successfully weld that, and we learned that welding by itself is an art. After all, we are trying to build accelerators, and welding is something that should be worked on its own. Therefore, now this whole thing is being commercialized. Let's see how it goes. Okay, I'm putting welding aside. Now on the right-hand side, people were discussing about this electron beam hardening. The idea is that you have a material in which you want to harden some parts. For example, you have an engine. You want the outside of the engine to be hard enough to resist elements, water, air. You don't want to have any problems with the outside part. However, the inner part where you have the internal combustion and tiny explosions, you want that part not hard, but soft enough to withstand these explosions. Therefore, surface hardening is something that is being looked after. In fact, it was going to be presented either in this conference or the one coming after. However, the student had some difficulties, and it is not going to be presented this time, but maybe in another conference. This is something that we managed to achieve in stainless steel, again, 304. By changing the energy deposited on the sample that you see here, we managed to get something like 30% hardening on the surface. Okay. Now, controlling the beam. As I said, we are using as interface LabVIEW. Although there are alternatives now, as I understand, written only in Python, for example, that would, I assume, that should be faster. However, the communication with the PLC setup has to be tested. Of course, the initial setup, as you can guess, we are all physicists, was some cables lying on the desk. It got tidier and tidier in time. And eventually, I think it's tidy enough. Once you have hardware doing the front-end control and the graphical user interface talking to the user, it is time to do other things, fancy things. One of these fancy things could be, for example, electron beam lithography. This is something also that is sought after. We are now in the process of developing a software library that would allow us to make any images like signature of an important person or the face of an important person. But of course, we started small, concentric circles. You might say that this is not a circle, this is an ellipse, and you would be right, of course. Now, this setup obviously requires some calibration, and we are in the process of doing these calibration and working on the material itself. Here you see that we have some improvements. This is an ongoing work. Oops, wrong direction. Okay, what is next? The title promised MEV level accelerator. Here is the idea to build an MEV level machine. It's called a rhodotron. It will become obvious why. Rhodos, rose in Greek. This is a machine that has been invented in, let's see, late 70s, tested in early 80s, and commercialized in late 80s or early 90s. The idea is the following. You have a setup with two concentric circles, inner circle, outer circle. This is a three-dimensional thing. It's a volume, in fact. And we are looking at the middle of it from the top. The electrons enter here and they move along this path. From here to here, they are accelerated if they enter the region with the correct RF phase. Here they are shielded from the RF field because it would have the wrong phase and that would decelerate. Here your electrons are once again in the correct phase and they accelerate once again. Here you have a magnetic field that would make them turn and protect from the wrong phase of the RF field. Once again, accelerate, protected, once again, accelerate and out. Perfect. We started working on the formula. We did some simulations. And when we started building things, disaster. It turns out getting the cheapest offer, accepting the cheapest offer was maybe not a good idea. Low cost has to be some lower limit, I think. Our student Sinan here has started learning about how to simulate a press. And we actually went to the guy who was running the press and said, this is how you should do it. And eventually we got the parts right. Other parts are being manufactured, or maybe it's finished by now by a CNC owner. And this is working at night to prepare. The thing is going to be hopefully vacuum tested this month. And we hope to get the first beam in 2023. You might ask, this is big. How are you going to make it transportable? Well, it will come. It will come here. Okay, since I mentioned it, it will be standing on its legs with wheels. But before going there, let me say a few things about power. You need RF power to run these things. We did 2D and 3D simulations. We realized that to get what we want, we need something like 50 kilowatts of power. Our operating frequency is in the FM band, 107.5. Luckily, when they were destroying the Çamlıca Hill to remove these power stations for radio and TV, we managed to acquire a number of FM power supplies from radio stations. The idea is to merge at least two of these guys to get enough power. So what have we done? We have individually tested all the power supplies, cleaned them up and rejuvenated them. That took a lot of time. Here we want to use a coaxial transmission line. Here it is, the transmission line. It's thick and big. This is a VNA. It has good transmission properties. We tested the RF signal generator, preamplifiers. Here is the low-level RF test setup. We can remote control it. That's also tested. But we didn't do the high-power tests because we need a good RF load. Now, there is something that we have not yet decided, whether to use a 3 dB adder and merge the two power supplies before and then feed the cavity, or use these two separately and merge, feed the cavity from two different locations. With the current design, this is possible. We have also designed a coupler, in fact, two. Well, they will be the same if we build two. Now we are in the state of checking the multipacking effects. Let's see. If you want to go beyond one MeV, the idea would be to equip the material with more magnets, more bending magnets, and do more turns. Typically, people do 5-8 turns or more. Otherwise, the system doesn't become usable. More than that, the system becomes unusable. In the meantime, we are developing the software for simulating. Instead of using CSD, a dedicated software does a better job. We have a number of designs to go up to 10 MeV. Well, 10 MeV is the industrial limit, and electrons are mostly used in industry. In, for example, sterilization, X-ray production, cross-linking, etc. And on wheels, without all the cooling material, that would be like a ton and a half, but still on wheels, so in principle, transportable. Okay, second part, protons. This has been also presented, I guess, in the past. Let me summarize you quickly. I see that I have been talking very slowly, time passes rapidly. Anyway, the idea is to prepare a 2 MeV LINAC, again, MeV level, a proton LINAC. The heart of the proton beam line is a radio frequency quadrupole operated at 800 megahertz. The extraction potential out of the ion source is 20 kilovolts. The beam current will be small, 1 milliamps, etc. Here is a cartoon. Here is the plasma chamber, ion source. Here you feed your hydrogen. Hydrogen is heated from the microwaves coming from a magnetron, classical kitchen magnetron with 2.45 gigahertz. And then you apply high voltage to kick out your protons. Here is your low energy beam transport, the two solenoids to focus, the measurement box to characterize the beam, and your RFQ hopefully will have an usable proton beam. Of course, underneath this fancy drawing, there will be some power supplies. Wrong direction again. Okay, here is the setup. This is now in Istanbul. Here is the magnetron. Here is the ion source. Here is solenoid one, measurement box, solenoid two. You see here an RFQ, but it has been added virtually. It is in the process of being manufactured. The ion source has been discussed here. It is an upgrade of a previous setup. Well, here is the magnetron, which transmits power. Here is the power line, an RF window. Here is the ionization chamber. These two solenoids, electromagnetic solenoids, for the cyclotron condition. And then the extraction is here. Here you see the drawing and the corresponding implementation. Of course, the vacuum system is here. And at the end, we put a Faraday cup to measure the current. We measured with this setup, typically 1.3 milliamps. This setup was nice, but it has been changed, upgraded. Why? Because, well, the electromagnets require a lot of current. They heat up, require cooling, water cooling. A student of ours worked on a permanent magnet ion source as an upgrade. How do you make this thing low cost? Instead of getting a circular magnet to provide the magnetic field in the Z direction, the idea was to purchase regular, what is that called? Neodymium magnets, a number of them arranged in a certain order to generate the equivalent magnetic field. This has been also tested, installed now, although I have the old photo. And shown that you can extract protons out of it. Here I gave you the hydrogen flow, extraction voltage, the vacuum value, and the typical current that we are working with. Okay, now this is the low energy beam transport. As I said, this is the solenoid, this is the measurement box, and this is the other solenoid. We have also two steerers, you have seen the photos. This is the output from our software, our design software, Demirci. Demirci now has this Leavitt section, which helps you to see the beam envelope. This is the RMS envelope. And then the dotted lines here are the RMS envelope enlarged 10 times, is 10 sigma, if you like. Here we are looking at the radius of the beam, RMS radius, 10 sigma radius, and the loss here. Losses occur because the beam sometimes at the very end hits the magnet aperture. Okay. M-box itself, you can of course go to Bergos and buy, but if you want to make it low cost, you start designing yourself by your vacuum chamber first, and then the equipment. We preferred using pneumatic cylinders to push the detectors inside the beam, and then when once done, take outside of the beam. The assembly looks like that. It contains a number of detectors. It contains, for example, a Faraday cup when simulated, when constructed, and also a pepper pot plate emittance measurement system. Pepper pot plate is something that that is a steel or tungsten sheet with tiny little holes. I should here thank our collaborator and friend, Dr. Ildai from Bilkent, for making these tiny, tiny holes with his fiber laser. Okay, here is the setup now. The idea here is to get some images on the display, fluorescent display, and then take the photos of the beam with and without this pepper pot plate to measure the beam shape and to measure the emittance. The beam profile, when analyzed, gives you the beam diameter, obviously, and then the emittance is another important parameter for accelerator physics. And here is the beam direction. This is the pepper pot plate. This is the fluorescent screen. To reflect the fluorescent screen's image towards the camera, we have a planar mirror here at 45 degrees. And typically the image is something like that. And the analysis is here. You measure here full width at half maximum, it gives you something like 16 millimeters. And then if you go back and see where this thing is here, here is about what, 50-ish, 50, 60, and this is what you see. This is radius, by the way. So what you read from this scale, you need to multiply by 2, obviously. Okay. Okay, long story short, we have done measurements in different places. We have been able to measure the beam emittance, the beam current. It's a pulsed 50 hertz pulsed beam here at the inside the measurement box and here at the end of the Leavitt system. And here is a comparison between simulated and measured values. Sometimes we are okay, sometimes we are off. Of course, this is ongoing work. Now, the heart of the matter, as I said, is the radio frequency quadrupole. The idea here is to make it transportable, smallest RFQ possible. To do that, you have to have a good design and you have to have high frequency. Highest frequency so far record is set by CERN, since they are operating and we are not, at 750 megahertz. We tried to surpass that value with 800 megahertz. Why 800 and why not 760? Simply because we had the power supplies conforming to this frequency. Here I summarized a little bit. It will be a tiny, teeny, small machine, about 12 centimeters or so diameter and 98 centimeters in total. It will be really, really small. The design has been discussed here previously, therefore I'm not going to go into the details. We can, if you like, later on. Let me show this one. This is a comparison between CERN's high frequency 5 MeV RFQ, CERN's PIXE RFQ at 2 MeV, and our RFQ at 2 MeV. Here they are just above a meter, 107 centimeters, and we are tiny bit below 1 meter, 98 centimeters, getting to the exact same 2 MeV and starting with the exact 20 kilovolts of extraction voltage. How is this thing achieved, you might ask? Well, of course, this is an optimization problem. And like CERN, we are optimizing the transmission. As you can see, they are accelerating only 30%, and so we are. So you say, okay, I'm going to make my RFQ short. I'm going to give up on accelerating all the particles. I'm going to accelerate only 30%. And the remaining particles, the only thing that I ask out of the remaining particles is that they don't hit the wall. We have only 10% of the protons hitting the wall. 90% of the non-accelerated ones are exiting with the same energy without hitting anywhere. The power problem, power is a problem, obviously. 5 MeV, they require 400 kilowatts. 2 MeV, they require 80 kilowatts. And we tried to squeeze out of the design the maximum that we could, and we ended up, at least with the 2D calculation, something below 50 kilowatts. Wrong direction again, okay. Here there was some CST movie which would show us bunching, but I think it is gone when I made a PDF out of it. Now, instead, let me show you the small vein. This is a four-vein RFQ, the large vein, the ditches for the RF fingers that you will see, and for the vacuum O-ring. Here is the completed and assembled RFQ being tested. By the way, this is module zero, made out of regular copper to understand better the manufacturing process. And here you see the tiny little thing being transported. Here are some more tests with vacuum. With two turbomolecular pumps, we were able to get to 1 to -6 millibars. The O-ring is this. It's a 3D O-ring like the ones used at Fermilab. But I think we can improve on these on these things. There are some, yeah, my eye is on the, yeah. Here are some electromagnetic tests. These are the tuners to make the field uniform. Here are the tuners installed on the test module. Here are the RF fingers, this thing installed again. There is a tuning procedure and a software developed by CERN. It's publicly available. We had to modify that, and we managed to reduce the dipole components and enlarge the quadrupole component that we need. You might say this is not flat. You're right, this is not flat, but it will be flat with two modules when it will be the real thing with 98 centimeters. This is the single short module of 45 centimeter plus some addition for the end of vein effects. Okay. We also worked on the surface roughness, something that we can measure with this device. It's less than 0.3 microns, so the production was all right. We studied the effect of the roughness on different modes. We will be in mode one. Therefore, this is the roughness here and the quality factor here. The quality factor drops, but not that much. We have also designed a loop tip type coupler with an alumina window. It has good performance. The design is here, but it is not being produced yet because there is something else that we need to study, the multipacking, which had affected us in the previous, in our previous work. We first managed to show the effects of multipacking. Multipacking means when there is a spark, tiny electrons, the secondary electrons go in an avalanche way, and then you have power loss in the transmission line. Here is going from light to dark, the power increases, and this is time, by the way, x-axis, and you see the number of particles floating around. Here is multipacking sparking happening. This can be changed through, I am sorry, I just need a few more minutes. You need to change this by changing the secondary electron yield constant of the material that you use to separate the vacuum from the air. And we are now trying to see what happens with different constants. Obviously, this is also time. The same thing repeated in CSD. The thing does not happen, but how to get to this constant experimentally, that is the challenge, of course. Now, power supplies. We have computed the power needed using different software. PharmTech is the traditional. Demirci can also do the setup, calculate the quality factor, and depending on the other parameters, can give you the power loss. So I had previously quoted the PharmTech value, which is less than 50, and Demirci reports a little bit more than 50. But of course, there will be losses on the power transmission line itself. So maybe 60 or 70 kilowatts is a safe bet. How do you get that? Well, we were lucky to receive a number of power supplies from TV stations, which are not operational anymore. One from TRT and one from Show TV. They are now being worked on, rejuvenated as well. They use tetrodes, Thales, 382 and 582. In CW, they don't give much power, but when you pulse them in pulse mode, they can give enough power to achieve the 50 kilovolts. But how do you get to that 50? Obviously, the two power supplies have to work in parallel or in tandem. The power should be added. The power adder setup is a what is called magic T in RF engineering. Basically, it's a device that adds power and outputs from one end. When power, when electromagnetic waves, they come in phase, and the out of phase component is sent out from this top component, which is produced and being tested here. This is the RF dump part. This is an old photo of the circulator. The circulator is here. If you have power, that goes here and something changes, for example, temperature, and then there is a there is a mismatch, and the reflected power should not go back and hit the power supplies. To protect the power supplies, you need a circulator, and the circulator will channel the power here and the reflected power to the RF dump. And this is that setup which was being tested. We also tested the signal generator, preamplifiers. These are solid state preamplifiers which provide something like 1.5 kilowatt each, circulator, waveguides, RF loads. They are all designed and produced by us. We didn't buy a circulator. We didn't buy a magic tea. We designed and got it built in industry. So what do we need now? We need to combine these setups and do a test at kilowatt level. So this is the status. Leavitt part is functioning, that we are happy with. The RFQ is being manufactured. We are, think now we have finalized the manufacturing procedure. Modules, the real modules 1 and 2 will be produced next, this month we start. But instead of regular copper, we will be using oxygen-free electric copper. Hopefully we can do an installation this year and then start vacuum testing next year. Final slide, thank you for your patience. We aim to have MeV level electron and proton beams by the end of, say, next year. The idea is to have a milliamp current. We try to maximize the local construction. Of course, this project has some educational value, but there might be also some application value. A 2 MeV proton beam could be used for particle-induced X-ray emission, which is a classical thing. And also, we could use, for example, at least we are at the threshold of doing neutron generation. It can also be used to test detectors, instrumentation, et cetera. We are always looking for good students, always. And we are also always looking for collaborations. For example, there are things that we don't know. Alumina and ferrites are not in our arsenal of knowledge. Thank you very much for your patience.
To Gökhan on Zoom, let's ask first. Can we have the lights on in the room, by the way? and in room?
You are 200. Full time.
One question, Ömer.
Regarding the electron-beam applications to material processing, you compared and contrasted to lasers, and you mentioned a few advantages and disadvantages. Can you comment on combining them together in the same in a single machine to do co-processing? Because actually, in terms of implementation, that does not look difficult at all.
That is true. One could combine the two setup in a single machine. However, the strength of using a laser beam welding is in the fact that you don't need vacuum. However, if you combine the two setup to use the same machinery, that means either you put one out of the vacuum and the other inside the vacuum, so that would be different to work on the same piece, or you put laser as well inside the vacuum, which you can do naturally. But then that really kills the advantage of the laser. So I couldn't think of a good application.
I wasn't thinking just of welding. I was thinking more like combining additive and subtractive manufacturing. So with the e-beam, I think you can do additive.
Yes.
And it's relatively probably much easier to do subtractive with the laser.
Depending on the material, we also did subtraction. If you use aluminum, for example, it melts like cheese in front of the electron beam. But for materials with higher Z, I don't know. I am guessing not, simply because there would be some sort of reflection from the laser, and I don't think that would be efficient, whereas the electron beam will penetrate.
How about insulators like glass in particular, where it's actually quite difficult to work with the laser?
With what?
With glass. Optically transparent materials.
Yeah.
You need
yeah.
ultra-fast lasers, which are expensive. Can you work on glass with electron beams?
Yes, yes. Also, there is something that I didn't mention. We are planning to take the electron beam out of the vacuum. Of course, we will lose some of the beam itself, some of the power, and we'll have a lot of complications, but at least this is something that we want to try next.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other urgent questions or discussions to Gökhan? Before
yes,
implementing sir. The idea to leave vacuum, do you plan to have a bigger vacuum vessel and do things, or?
The bigger vacuum vessel is being prepared, as you can see in the last slides of the electron part. And there are ideas. You see, this is like a meter and 70, 80 centimeters height and a meter and a half diameter. So we could brew some beer in it.
Okay. Let's thank the speaker once again. On behalf of the entire mission.
Thank you, thank you.
And this ends this morning's session. We will have a lunch break until 2:30, after which I think we will continue with parallel sessions that are not in this room, but in the high school building, right? Okay, have a nice break.